Yeah, good afternoon. I'll welcome again for one more lecture on modern manufacturing methods. The last class where I have stopped is regarding this. So we have been discussing about rapid prototyping, right? So as the name indicates, it is a process of building a model or prototype at a very faster rate. Okay, so that is called as a rapid prototyping. So we have discussed in detail clearly about the rapid prototyping process. Okay, now we'll see exactly this is what I mentioned in the last class, that is, what is your rapid prototyping. So basically, what are the various steps involved in rapid prototyping? Yes, sir. So these are the things what we discussed in the last class. And today's class we'll be discussing about the different processes. Okay, right. Now, as this particular slide, again, once again, I'll give you exactly what is this. This is basically a technology where a physical model will be produced layer by layer. So you can't get a straight away product like that. So your product will be designed and it will be produced as a layer by layer manner from their CAD models. Okay, and you are not going to use any tools, you are not going to use any dies, fixtures, etc. And most of the times no human intervention also needed, because it's just a connection between a computer or a laptop or computer to the machine, which is a rapid prototyping machine or 3D printing machine. So it can whatever complex shapes, that's the main advantage of rapid prototyping, is so very complex shapes also I can easily make it, because I can draw it easily in a CAD software like ProE, CATIA. These are the modeling softwares, and from there straight away I can give input to the 3D printing machine or rapid prototyping machine, which understands a language called as STL. That's a standard translator language. Okay, so that's the STL language, because the STL language only the machine, rapid prototyping machine, will understand. So that's your rapid prototyping. And what the advantage means, and you are designing a prototype or a model, and at the design stage itself, if any error is there after fitting, you can just easily rectify it, and again you can take that part for what is called as assembly, etc. So that's the main advantage with your rapid prototyping. And moreover, it's a very very quick process. Within no time you can produce the prototype or a model or a product. Okay, so that's a major advantage. Now, this already we discussed, that the very all these things are very important steps of your rapid prototyping, that is CAD modeling, conversion of CAD to STL, STL to layers, slicing into layers, then finally input to the machine, and finally you will get a product and that will be finished. So these are the five major steps of any rapid prototyping process, right? So obviously the CAD modeling design, I need a computer software, and I must need a language or a STL format. So I have to convert that the CAD model into STL format, and obviously the STL is nothing but a stereo lithography, that called as the standard translator language. That process is called as stereo lithography, and the STL file will be converted into layers, because the rapid prototyping machine or 3D printing machine won't be executing at once the entire product. So it will be just goes as a layer by layer. Okay, then obviously you'll be getting finally the model, and you'll finish the model by using the finishing technique. Okay, clean and finishing the model. So these are the basic steps already what we discussed. Okay, now this already I have discussed how. This is the first one, CAD model creation, and this is how I can convert into STL format. Then you have to convert that into layers or slicing format with a pre-processing software or slicing software, where it will be converted and it may deposit the material of the order of a thickness of 0.01 mm to 0.7 mm, okay, by building it layer by layer. Okay, that's the slicing. Now obviously, once it goes to the rapid prototyping machine or 3D printing machine, the fourth step is it will be generating the model layer by layer. It will give the finally the model, and you will be using materials like polymers, okay, then your metal or etc., paper etc. will be materials used for your models, okay, right? And obviously finally it will be finishing using a painting or sealing or sanding etc. for good appearance as well as durability. So that's how your steps for rapid prototyping process. Now very important one is, so before going for exactly what exactly your rapid prototyping process or fundamentals of a rapid prototyping process, so just have a small video make you clear about even better about your rapid prototyping process. Okay, so just watch this. Yeah, it's playing now. Just I think you can easily assess this one, because it's a very interesting video which gives you clearly about your what you called as the process of 3D printing or additive manufacturing. Okay, so just it's loaded. So 1 minute.
How would you like to have a machine that could make anything you wanted? Sounds good, doesn't it? Well, this is now possible through the magic of 3D printers. And while you might not yet see a 3D printer sitting alongside your toaster or your TV at home, you will start to see them more and more in places like schools, in shops, in hospitals, and many other places.
Nowadays.
But what is a 3D printer? And how does 3D printing allow us to make almost anything from nothing? Well, first, we need to take a step back and look at how we normally make stuff. Basically, there are four ways we make things. The first way is called subtractive manufacturing. In subtractive manufacturing, we take a lump of material, like wood or metal or stone, and we cut away some parts of it to make the thing we want. So, we remove or subtract, just like we do in maths, the material we don't need to create something. This could be carving a wooden chair from a tree or making a statue from some stone. The second way of making stuff is called forming. And here we take a block of material and we apply a force to change its shape. My personal favorite of a formed object is Wallace and Gromit, made by shaping or forming plasticine. The third way we make things is called casting. And this is where you take a solid material, you make it into a liquid, and you pour it into a mold. And a nice example of casting, one of my favorites, is the way we make chocolate bunnies and Easter eggs. There's also a fourth way we make stuff, and that is called additive manufacturing.
So this gives you the information about additive.
This is where we have nothing to begin with, and you take your material and you add it exactly where you want it until you have your final object. 3D printing is one type of additive manufacturing. and it involves making an object by adding material one tiny layer at a time. So, how do you do that? Well, it all starts by making a drawing of the thing you want on your computer. The computer then makes a special kind of file which it sends to the 3D printer. And the 3D printer reads that file and prints the object layer by layer to make the thing you want. Sounds interesting, but why would you want to do that? 3D printing can help people to make new shapes and new objects that were not previously possible, and all sorts of different materials can be used, like plastics or metals or food, or even living cells that your body is made of. So, who uses 3D printers? Who cares about this? Engineers are using 3D printers to make parts of jet engines that are lighter and stronger, to make airplanes more efficient and use less fuel. Doctors are using 3D printers to make new hands and arms and legs that are perfectly fitted for the patients who need them. Even chefs are experimenting to make amazing new types of food that you just couldn't even imagine. And hospitals are using 3D printers to make new body parts for people, such as new bones, to repair really bad fractures, perhaps to the face or to the hand. And even using 3D printers to make objects from cartilage, the thing that your ear is made of, to make new ears for people who may have had a bad accident. One day, we may even be able to 3D print new organs inside your body, like kidneys or livers, using the patient's own cells in these printers. 3D printing is already changing the way we make stuff, and who knows what amazing things that you could make with a 3D printer in the future.
Okay, so yeah, I think now you are able to understand what exactly the process of additive manufacturing or 3D printing. Okay, so coming back again, so these are the four important things for your rapid prototyping machines or 3D printing machine, which are actually given here as the four major aspects of RP. So rapid prototyping or rapid machining, RM. Okay, so I must need some sort of input. Right, so what and all input, and what is the method which is being adopted, and what is the material which is being used, and what are the applications by using that particular process. Okay, so whether it's being used for medical, it's being used for something like automotive industries, so like that, there are plenty of applications where you are going to use this particular rapid prototyping models or 3D printed models. So input, method, material, and application. Now, what is exactly input? So this is nothing but, as input, we have to produce a 3D model, which is actually given in the form of a STL to a standard language, translator language to the machine, okay, which produces the model. So this is input refers as the electronic formation required to describe the physical object with 3D data. So I can use this in two ways. Either I can build a computer model using a CAD system, okay, or straight away I can go for one more process, which is nothing but a reverse engineering. Okay, this is a new term for you. So which actually requires a data acquisition. Data acquisition means there must be some interface. Okay, so where I'll be getting the model. In reverse engineering, you have a wide range of equipment digitizer to capture data points of the physical model and reconstruct into CAD system. So exactly, you have some actual product that will be reverse engineering. That is, engineering means you'll be following the actual design principles as step-by-step process to build the product. Now, what is the reverse engineering here? Already the final product in a beautiful shape is available for you. Now what happens, you are going to reverse engineering that one, means you will capture all the data points, which is actually called as a digit, that data points will be actually given to a particular machine or a particular model, where it will be called as a equipment digitizer, which reconstruct it into CAD system. Then once the CAD system, the model is ready, then I can use any type of a rapid prototyping process to produce the actual product. Okay, So that is the basically the input. Now the second one will be a method, right? So this is very important. So let me just take one highlighting pen. Yeah. Now see here, the method of producing a 3D printing model or the prototype or model is very, very important. So there are nowadays, you see throughout the world, you have 20 vendors for rapid prototyping systems. Okay, and each and every vendor, that is the suppliers, will be using a different technique or a method. Okay, some they may use, they actually divide into these types, that is photo curing, we'll discuss it afterwards, cutting and gluing or joining, melting and solidifying, or fusing and joining or binding, fusing and joining or binding. So like this, you have a plenty of three methods available by means of which you will carry out your rapid prototyping process. Okay, and first, if you take most popular one is your photo curing process. The photo curing process. So the photo curing can be divided into categories, like you will be using a single laser beam to produce the model, or you will be using a double laser beams, or you have something like a masked lamp. So we'll discuss everything in the coming slides. So photo curing technique, most of the times this is a method used for rapid prototyping process. Okay, now next one. So I have discussed about the what you called as input method. Now material. Now what is the material which I can use to produce the model is the material. Initial state of material may be either a solid or liquid or powder state. So any form you can give a input for a 3D printing machine or rapid prototyping machine. Okay, so it may be like a solid, it may be like a liquid, or it may be in the form of a powder. Okay, so in solid state, it may be in the form of a pellets or wires or laminates. So that's the, in solid state means the input will be like a solid, that will be in the form of a pellets or wire or laminates. Okay, and most of the times you will be using these type of materials like paper, nylon, wax, resins, metals and ceramics. Okay, so these are the some of the materials which are being used to produce the 3D printed model. Okay, and what are the major applications of your rapid prototyping or 3D printed models is, they may be divided into three groups. So some have application in the design field, some have application in engineering and analysis and planning departments, and somewhere it has application in tooling and manufacturing. And a wide range of industries can benefit, because nowadays you see that the 3D printing is getting popular. Because medical also, you can see nowadays, as I already explained in the video to start with the class, that is nowadays you can see, and finally you may, a day will come where the 3D printing machine may produce the organs like liver, kidney, etc., using the cells of the body, because you must need some form of an input. Okay, so that will be, assume that the cells will be given. So the cell in the form of, so you have a 3D printed model just equal or having representing same as your liver or kidney, etc. So there are plenty of areas where you will be using your 3D printed models or the models produced by rapid prototyping, that is aerospace, automotive, biomedical and consumer goods, electrical and electronic products. Yeah, you see a particular laptop, if you have, so laptop has plenty of parts. Okay, your keyboards, okay, your switches, all the things you can have a 3D printing products. Okay, so these are things what I need, that is input. Yes, then you have a method, material, as well as applications. So these are the four aspects of your rapid prototyping. Next we'll go for what is the basic advantage. So already I've been discussing about the advantages of rapid prototyping process. So almost any shape or geometric feature can be easily produced, because I can design anything on a CAD software. So that will be easily produced by using a rapid prototyping machine. So obviously you can see here the time and cost, it's almost like a range of 50% to 90% of will be reduced compared to the conventional process. So there will be a reduction in time as well as cost by around 50%, and errors and flaws can be detected at an early stage, because you are detecting at early stage, you are making a model. So any error, any flaws available in the product, easily you can detect it and you can correct it. Okay. So RP or RM, so rapid prototyping or rapid machining, can be used in different industries and number of fields of life like medicine, art and architecture, marketing. So a lot of areas where you can use this RP parts or RM parts. Okay. So discussions with the customer can start at an early stage, because you are finishing the model within no time, and customer may be have interaction with that. Yeah, he may give some feedback, so I can implement that feedback, I can change it, and I can make the things according to the taste of the customer. Now assemblies can be made directly in one go. So obviously what happens, the product, final product is available readily, so assemblies straight away I can make. It's not like you have to wait and you have to wait for the product for hours like that. So you can avoid that time. Material waste is reduced because you are taking all the precautions at the design stage, which reduces the material. And you don't require any tooling, because there is no tools like jig, fixture, cutting tools as needed. So still you are going to produce the product. You can design the product. So the designers and the machinery can be in separate place. Okay. So need not that the person who is working, okay, and the machine has to be in the same place. Suppose you take a CNC machine or a NC machine or a lathe or milling machine, whatever may be thing. So you have to be, the person has to be there nearer to that to operate that. But here it's not a thing. The machine will be somewhere and your control will be somewhere. Okay. Then you can produce the product. So those are the very advantages. Then you have disadvantages. So obviously the price of a machinery and material. Now to produce a 3D printed model, the material is a special material what is being used. Okay. So that is very costly. And the machinery, that is, I assume that I want to have a 3D printing machine. Okay. Now you can't see this nowadays, everywhere in the houses, like what he explained in the video. Now this may be, you can see in the research organizations, okay, like you have DRDOs, you have what you called as NTPCs, so somewhere the products, you have manufacturing sectors, DRDO, those things, where you have plenty of amount for the manufacturing, so they can afford for the 3D printing machines, okay. So surface, normally what happens, because there is nothing like finishing everything. So the surface which is produced straight away from the 3D printing depends upon the material what you are going to bed. So obviously it will be rough compared to the machined surfaces which are made by lathe or milling machine, etc. And some materials are brittle. So what is the here? You are using some sort of a material which will be used to produce the 3D printed model. Now what happens sometimes? That may be a brittle, So suddenly that product already you built and you're straight away you're using that product. And sometimes what happens, because of the material properties or material, inferior material what you are going to use, it may be a brittle one, then it may be getting damaged when you are going for a assembly. Okay. So the strength of RP parts, that is rapid prototype parts, are weaker in Z direction than in other. So because this is a 3D products what you are going to get, so most of the times in Z direction you are going to give the material, you are getting a material. So in Z direction little bit inferior compared to the X and Y directions. Okay, right. Now this is very important, and or exactly to start like this. So what are the different types of rapid prototyping processes? Okay. Now some it will be called as a liquid based process, some like a solid based, some are powder based. It's based upon the input, what type of input you are using. So if you use a liquid as an input, it's called as a liquid based. If you use a solid as an input, it's called as a solid based. And finally, a powder it will be using, it is called as a powder based. Okay. Now, liquid based RP system have initial form of its material in liquid state. So as I indicated already, so most of the times this liquid based system, you have the initial process in liquid state and you have a process called as curing, where the liquid, because our product, final product must be in solid state, so it has to be cured. So I'll be using the process of curing, because input is liquid that has to be converted finally into solid state model. Okay, that's about the liquid based or rapid prototyping process. Now, what is solid based process? Except for powder, solid based RP systems are meant to encompass all forms of material in solid state. So obviously you'll be giving the input as in the solid form, and finally you'll be getting in the solid form. And what is the input? It may be a wire which is in solid, which is like a solid, a roll which is like a solid, a laminate or a pellets which will be like a solid, what is going to give as input. And finally the product will be as the respect of whatever the input. So finally I'll be getting a model in solid state. And the last one, the powder based. In a strict sense, powder is by and large in solid. Obviously the solid powder is also like a solid in solid state only, but intentionally it is created outside to make it as a powder, so that to improve the structure of the grains. Okay, so that's the thing. Most of the times you will go for either liquid based or solid based input for a rapid prototyping systems. Okay, now, so this particular table gives you, yes, these are the things what is going to use. That is, if I supply liquid as an input, the supply phase is liquid. What are the different process where finally I'll be getting the 3D printed model? Okay, so these are the things. The first one is stereolithography, then solid based curing, fused deposition modeling, ballistic particle manufacturing. And most of the times you have the first and third one is very much popular. That is stereolithography process, as well as FDM or fused deposition modeling technique to produce a 3D printed model. So most of the times the 3D printing or a 3D printer, nowadays you can see in the industries or education institution, you'll have a particular technique known as FDM technique or fused deposition modeling technique. Okay, so obviously what happens, it will be forming as a layer by layer. So liquid layer curing, that's the process. That's a layer by layer, it will form as a solid. So first it will be like a liquid, it will be solidified. So like that, what will happen in the STL, that is serial lithography technique. Now obviously, finally it will be converted into photopolymerization. Okay, that is the final solid will be like a photopolymerization technique. It will be converted from liquid to the solid. And finally, what are the materials you can use as part of this particular stereolithography processes? I can use the photopolymers like acrylates, epoxies, colorable resins, etc. Okay, which will be used in a stereolithography technique. Similarly, you have solid based curing. So obviously liquid layer curing and milling, and photopolymerization same. And I can use only photopolymers as a material. And similarly, this is very important. That's the FDM, what exactly are most of the times it will be used. That is extrusion of melted polymer. So you have a thing which is actually supplied like a wire. Okay, so that wire will be actually extruded, and that will be solidified by cooling technique. And most of the times, all the 3D printed models may be of the material of ABS, polyacrylate, or wax, metals, or ceramics. Anything is polymers are, these are the polymers which are mentioned in the parenthesis here. And you can use a wax, metals, or ceramics with binder will be used as a wire, which actually deposits, and layer by layer you will produce a model. Okay, so these are the different techniques. And powder, if it's a powder, so these are the thing what will happen. And if it's solid, you have laminated object manufacturing. The process is called as LOM, laminated object manufacturing, and you have deposition of sheet material, and there is no phase change. Finally, what is the material you can use for a solid? So you can use a paper as a polymer as a input material for the 3D printed model going to obtain. Okay, so this the brief, in brief, how, what are the input processes, rapid processes, how the material is going to fit as a input. Okay, now right, so what I'll do, I'll just stop here, and I'll just take maybe another 10 minutes, then we'll join for one more class where I'll be explaining in clearly. There are two techniques very much popular, that is stereolithography operators, or SLA. It's called as popularly SLA, stereolithography operators, SLA, and how it works, what are the advantages, what are the disadvantages. Okay, then we'll go for the exactly the one more process, that is a FDM, fused deposition modeling technique. Okay, so which is very much popular in 3D printing machines. Okay, so hope you understood, and do join maybe another 10 minutes. Okay, thank you.